Tis I, Dr. Dementia, and it's time to join a guild. Or all the guilds, for that matter. Especially with the 8th expansion of Dominion that was released in June 2013. A small expansion like Alchemy and Cornucopia, which thankfully, after the last video, I need a break from it. We've got a big money theme in this mini expansion here, both in the gaining and purchasing side of the game. So we're going to go into a couple of small mechanics before we go into the small list of cards. We got 13 new cards to talk about in this set. Let's get to it! Now, the first major mechanic we're going to discuss in this expansion is a pivotal one that's used not only in guilds, but also a future expansion we will look at down the line, and that is in the form of coffers. Coffers are coin tokens that you can receive as a result of specific cards in this set. They are specifically used during your buy phase. Each coffer you have gives you an extra plus one coin each when you purchase something by removing the coffer. So you can combine these in conjunction with your physical treasure cards and terminal coin on action cards in order to purchase something very powerful. Now, just to note, you do not need to use any of the coffers on your turn. You do not need to use all of the coffers on your turn. They stay with you throughout the entire game. So you can rack up a lot of coffers and purchase something insanely good. You could basically purchase a colony if you had enough coffers to do it without even touching any physical coin in your set. However, there are a couple of things I do need to point out. First off, for using coffers like this, you definitely need to take advantage of a lot of buy power if there are additional buys. Otherwise, the coffers are gonna really run out of energy. You're gonna really only use them in circumstances when you don't have enough physical treasure in your hands in order to purchase something that you know is gonna make your deck work wonders. In addition, black market, because of the fact that you are using treasures during your action phase, you are not allowed to take advantage of coffers during the effect of black market, which means you can't use the extra coffers to take advantage of a card that will basically one-side the game. That is specifically set for that very reason. But all in all, you are now essentially playing with a bank account in addition to your deck. You have virtual money. And now you have to decide whether or not you want to hoard the coin or actually slowly take advantage of any of the coffers, or just take all of them and just have a sweet-ass mega turn. That's where you need to have extra buys. This is a fun mechanic, and I am glad it sticks around, unlike potions and alchemy, because this changes the way some cards can be played. And the second mechanic of this set is a unique one specifically for guilds, and that is the concept of overpay. About a third of the cards in this set have an additional effect where you can overpay the cost of the card in order to gain a specific effect. For example, if a card costed 4, then you could pay 1 extra past that 4 to gain an extra effect on top of purchasing the card. Now, this is something that didn't entirely take off, but it was something that was a unique kind of situation that worked well with the coffers. So by using the coffers, it gives you the ability to overpay on some cards. Nothing major, but the mechanics do change the cards up a little bit, and we'll go into each of those when we discuss the cards specifically. So the first card we're going to take a look at for guilds is Advisor. Costing 4 to purchase, plus 1 action. Reveal the top 3 cards of your deck. The player to your left chooses one of them. You discard that card and put the rest into your hand. Now, we've talked about previous cards that really depend on deck tracking. This is more of a type of card where it depends on a strong balance for your deck. So you're looking at specifically using Visor in situations where you are limited on thinning, but there is a lot of junking attacks, both of the curse generation and the ruin generation variety. This is going to take careful consideration depending on when you get and use Advisor. You have to be very careful. There are a couple of circumstances where you want to avoid using this. First off, and this is weird, it's a mid-game card specifically, because in the early game, All you have are your estates or shelters and your coppers. You don't want to lose a single copper because it will detrimentally affect your initial plays and force you to really lose out on getting to those nice price points you're looking for. In the end game, when you've thinned out your deck and you have started greening a little bit with your more powerful cards, you have to avoid the top cards such as your Platinums, your Grand Markets, even King's Courts, even Tactician. You need to make sure you don't lose out on this. Mid-game is where you have a nice balance, where you haven't entirely thinned out the deck, but you're still able to have a few extra cards. So this gives you a little bit of deck inspection and some sifting at your opponent's leisure. Now, even if they discard the card, fortunately, you can still get it back depending on the circumstance. Courtyard and Harbinger are two of the top cards to recover the card that was discarded, so not everything is entirely lost. But you want to make sure you have draw cards besides Advisor. You want to have them already in your hand, because if you lose out on the only draw card that gets discarded because of Advisor's effect, you basically will have a shitty turn. So, there's not much in terms of synergies. This requires careful planning and consideration on your part. Again, this is specifically more of a mid-game card when you can filter out what is necessary for you and give your opponent the choice of a crappy card. If you're able to do that correctly, that works out great. I would consider Advisor more in your junking games. Heavy junking in the Ruins or Curses are going to be where this card is going to be more useful than not. Early game or late game, you could potentially lose out on something powerful and potentially lose the lead as a result of it, even lose the game. So this takes careful planning. This is a very unique card, and because of when you use it, not many cards specifically for the mid game, but this is an interesting one nonetheless. Next card we're going to look at is the start of simple coffer regeneration, and that is Baker. Costing 5 to purchase, plus 1 card, plus 1 action, plus 1 coffer. In addition, for setup, each player gets plus 1 coffer at the beginning of the game. Now, this is the only card that has this initial setup, so there's a couple of things that make this more useful. First off, having the extra coffer at the beginning of the game means that your starting hands gain a bit of a bump. You could turn a 5-2 into a 6-2 or a 5-3, or a 4-3 split into a 5-3 or a 4-4 split, giving you more versatility in the beginning of the game. So that's already a positive. Not to mention, having this as a cantrip with a coffer, so the coffer gets to stay with you throughout the course of the game until you use it. This is a much more viable choice on a throne room or King's Court when you can pick up a lot of coffers early on in the game. Throne room especially. The only downside is that 5 cost price point, and that is tough to chew on, but it is still a decent source of payload. I'm not saying it's the best source of primary payload. There could be some cards that's a little bit cheaper than doing this, but if you can start adding up the coffers, you can really take advantage of this. Also, as a ruling, if Baker is in the Black Market deck, then you will still get the coffers at the beginning of the game. It doesn't matter where it's located. Just had to put that in for food for thought. This is an excellent card, and as a cantrip, you can't go wrong with it. There's no negative repercussions. I would say that is at least the best part about it. Yes, you'll pay 5, but if you have a way to play multiple of them a turn, it works out. So, if you want to get more of them, cost reduction on Ironworks, best option there. However, if University is in play, you could probably Throne Room or King's Court at University to get multiple Bakers, and then you have cantrips to go through your deck, basically getting you the coffers so you have it. This is an anytime card. Early game, mid game, late game. You get this early on, you can start building up the coffers. And this is a card for potential pileouts, so cities become a little bit more useful with it. This is a very good card and a nice way to introduce coffers into a new game for new players. So I wasn't entirely truthful when I said that your coffers could only be used in the buy phase. The next card we're going to look at actually allows you to use the coffers in a much more interesting way. The card we're going to talk about is Butcher. Costing 5 to purchase. First, you get plus 2 coffers. Then you may trash a card from your hand. If you do, remove any number of tokens from your coffers and gain a card, costed up to the cost of the trash card, plus one more coin per token removed. Now, first thing I need to explain, you can remove zero coffers if you so desire. I don't think you would want to do that, but this is the only card that allows you to use your coffers before your buy phase, and it's a remodel variant at that. Let's look at it this way. First off, you get two coffers right off the bat just by using the card, and then you can have the option of using the remodel effect. So let me give you an example. Let's say you use the estate and you had no coffers to begin with. You would be able to trash the estate, use the two coffers, you would be able to pick up something at four costs. Relatively a lot easier using that than something like Remake, when you could just trash an estate for one extra and then trash the card you get for one more extra. This gives you a lot more versatility. And if you're using something like Baker in a game, then you have one extra coffer to begin with, potentially a minimum of five to take advantage of. So you have a lot more options available to you. More importantly, you have a lot more expensive options if you're relying on your coffers to do a lot of your coin generation for the remodel effect. This is great. This is fantastic. And this makes it a lot easier to hit higher price points. You could turn a gold with coffers easily into a platinum or a colony, skipping over the province just to begin with. This is great, especially with cost reduction cards, making it a lot easier to hit those high price points. And if you can basically King's Court and Throne Room the Butcher and use the plus coffers first in order to do the remodel effect, you can walk away with a lot of versatility. And in a game with limited buys, this is the card that's going to save you. So you will get not only fantastic deck thinning, but you will also get your high price points without a lot of work that you're used to. Even with a 5 cost for this card, it's still recommended to get it in the early game just to start on your estates and then work on your terminal space and start working on generating coffers until you are ready to trash some of your more disgusting cards. You could even start with the shelters, just to turn them into estates, and then move up the chain. There's nothing wrong with that. And once you're done hitting the thinning level that you want for your deck, then use the butchers. You get 5 to begin with. In addition to the coffers, you're at 7 minimum. If you've already stockpiled coffers, you could walk away with some good stuff. So, this is definitely a very early game card. You could pick this up in the mid or the late game, depending on what's available to you. If you can hit the price points fast enough and get the butcher into action before your opponent can, you can generate fantastic power. And this is another card which works out wonderfully throughout the course of the game, where you don't have to worry about getting any bad repercussions. And I want to say one last thing. This helps you against your junketing attacks, both the curses and the ruins. Getting those out of there can potentially give you something a lot better. This is an awesome card and a good way to use coffers other than the buy phase. Perfect. Next up on the list, we have Candlestick Maker. Costing 2 to purchase, plus 1 action, plus 1 buy, plus 1 coffer. Simple as that. Weak, non-terminal, stop card. But it offers coffers and buys, something that you need if you're going to use coffers. Now, not much more needs to be said about this card, but this is a good source of payload. It's better than a copper because of the fact that you can hold on to the copper coffers long enough, and they can have a significant effect being able to hit price points, and you can spike large and quick before anybody else can. But having the coffers and the buys can sometimes yield diminishing returns. You may not need a lot of buys, but that's nothing to be scoffing at. And it at least gives you a chance to play on draw power, which is heavily needed for Candlestick Maker. So you need something like Scrying Pool or even Wandering Mistral just to be able to pull into some action cards that will help continue into your deck. Draw is potent, and it is absolutely necessary. Other than that, not much more. It's simple and unique, and at two costs, it's easy to pick up. You could King's Court Throne Room on the card? Sure, get a few more actions. If you have it, Diadem would work wonders because of the action generation. Coffers are going to be useful. You will at least get some coin generation on that turn, and I could potentially see a remodel, replace, remake on a copper into the Candlestick Maker, because at the very least, the coffers you can stack up. The coppers you might not want in your deck the entire time, especially if you're not dealing with copper strategies and Moneylender or Coppersmith is not available. Hell, not even Counting House or Beggar for that matter is going to be in your kingdom. This is an early game card because of the cost. Mid game possibly. Don't pick this up on the late game because unless you absolutely need the buys, you should have had it already in the early to mid game. It's not bad, but again, relies on draw power in order to be successful, and at least some sifting, but still not bad. Next up, we're going to look at the first of the overpay cards, and that is Doctor. Costing 3 to purchase, name a card. Reveal the top 3 cards of your deck, trash the matches, put the rest back in any order. If you overpay, per 1 cost overpaid, look at the top card of your deck, trash it, discard it, or put it back. Now, this is a very interesting card. This is essentially deck thinning with a little bit of luck involved, but it has more of a viable use in the early game, especially if you open with a 5-2 split. Getting it on a 5 gives you an overpay of 2, which means you can potentially get rid of any estates and or shelters that you don't need in your deck. So Hovel, Overgrown Estate, and the regular estates are good targets for this. Other than that, it can be effective thinning, but it's tricky on being able to use it. This is not something you would potentially use after the early game, unless, especially if Chapel is present on the field. But this primary overpay effect is going to be useful. Now, some people could potentially save up on coffers, especially if Baker or Candlestick Maker are options on the field, giving you a chance to really overpay on the card using the coffers, and then basically thinning your deck out of any and all junk. This is good on also countering curse generators and looters as well for ruins, because then you can get those out of your deck as well. The timing has to be right, however. But funny enough, cards such as Cartographer can set your deck up for that junk elimination. Being able to look at the top 4 of those cards, discarding the ones that you know you don't want to trash, and then putting the rest back gives you at least a chance to being able to do this. However, curses are going to be a much better target because of the fact you need to match any of those curses. They have to be exactly curses. But if it's ruins, you could have one of every ruin, and that would not really hurt you hard. Other than that, niche uses. You're basically looking at early game to take advantage of this card, and then when you've finally gotten the worst out of your deck, then you can begin really using it to your full potential. I don't see this being used very late into the mid game, or even into the late game for that matter, unless curse generation is a very, very big problem. I'd say Doctor is going to get more power out of overpay than anything else, and that's going to be highly useful. If you're going to use it into the mid game, then you're going to want to be able to save up enough coffers or enough treasure to overpay into this so extensively, you basically will find any and all cards that you do not need. Past the mid game? No. But early, it's going to have its strongest power. Mid game will still have uses. Overall, it's not a bad card for its effect. It can be useful. Just be careful when you play it. Next, we have another new overpay action card in the form of Herald. Costing 4 to purchase, plus 1 card, plus 1 action. Reveal the top card of your deck. If it's an action card, play it. And if you overpay, per 1 cost overpaid, put any card from your discard pile onto your deck. Now, this is an unusual cantrip that has a very interesting effect. Herald can essentially function as not only that same cantrip, but an effective draw. But you need an action card in order for it to work well. So your deck needs to be built around a lot of action cards. Now, right off the bat, I will say your ruins will at least get sifted out as a result of Herald. So that if you are dealing with a lot of ruin generation, Herald's a good card to go about it. The question comes, to being able to get the cards necessary to be able to pull off Herald's Effect. Now, thankfully, there are cards such as Secret Passage and Apothecary that will be able to not only take a card from your hand, putting it onto the deck, allowing you to automatically play it, but also being able to sift through your deck for the junk that is going to prevent you from playing those cards. Another decent card would be Cartographer, getting that set up, but it also could suck if you could get Cartographer right off of there. And with that in mind, you don't want to draw into Tactician either with Herald's Effect, because then you just lose out on that entire turn, and you might have something good for it. Now, looking at its overpay effect, while being minor, I mean, it can be situationally helpful. I mean, being able to top deck a card for your next turn, it could depend on the circumstances, but if you're going to overpay on Herald, it's going to go into a discard pile. You won't be able to take advantage of it unless you get the Herald on top of your deck before anything else. And by that point, you probably lost out on the strategy. There's not many times when you're going to want to be able to do that. And Herald's Effect is going to become less reliable, especially if you are heavily greening. With provinces and colonies, it's going to be tough. So you need cards that are going to be able to help you. But other than that, there's not many other options. I mean, one good example, at the very least, you could probably go with is Patrol. Because then at least you can get the victory cards into your hand first, giving you a much better chance to pull into an action card. But you could also still pull into some treasures too. I mean, yes, if we're going to talk about Patrol, yes, Scout is another option too. I really don't see this being super, super useful unless you are dealing in a situation where most of your money is coming from Terminal. But overall, you're limited in options unless your deck is built around it. This is a card that heavily, heavily is powerful based on the kingdom. So, if the action cards that are available into the kingdom are enough that you can overdraw into the deck and generate your treasure as a result of it, then yeah, I would say Herald's great. But in terms of its overall usefulness and effect, this isn't an early game card because you're starting with either Shelters or Estates plus your Coppers. You're not going to get anything out of it. Late game, super green. You might have hard times pulling into it. It's definitely a mid-game card when you're still building up your own kingdom against your opponent, and it requires having some decent cards at least being able to work well for you. I mean, you need specific cards, and the ones that are normally good for synergies are not going to be great if you pull into them using Herald. Overall though, mid-game card, it's interesting. I wouldn't say it's powerful, but it's not weak. It's interesting. It's really dependent on what's there for you and what's coming up in your deck, so you're going to have to plan very carefully before you use this particular cantrip. It's not bad, though. Next card we're going to look at is a very interesting terminal draw card, and that's Journeyman. Costing 5 to purchase, name a card. Reveal cards from your deck until you reveal 3 cards without that name. Put those cards into your hand and discard the rest. Now, I say this is terminal draw, but this is definitely a lot of sifting involved with it. And because I consider it terminal draw, village support is very helpful. Now, this particular type of sifting, though, is very good against junk attacks. However, it is basically more prominent when you do it against junking of a specific kind. Now, it can be curses, it can be ruins, it can be coppers, estates, and shelters. Any of those will work. The problem is, you need to focus on one and exactly one type of junk, and that basically will change depending on the type of game you're playing. And as the game gets later and later into it, it's going to become less powerful because you have basically more diversity, and possibly the junking is going to either slow down or stop altogether. While it does give you a mild bit of deck control, you need to have a couple of considerations in mind. In the early game, for example, if you did get this on a 5-2 split, your main goal is to focus primarily on either your estates and or shelters. Now, it's easier with your estates because they're the exact same card. Your shelters, however, are all 3 different cards. So depending if you've already trashed the hovel and the overgrown estate and only have the necropolis, yes, you could make this work a lot better. But with estates, it's a lot easier because you could just name estates and get the carpets that will help you. This makes it very useful in a specific early gameplay when estates are your primary source of victory point coverage rather than having the shelters. I would like to say this uses deck tracking, but as your deck is being built, it's kind of hard to really take advantage of it. And I don't see, I mean, basically you would have to sort your deck out in a way in order to ignore that. Basically, you'd have to sort out your deck in a way that's going to make it so that you can draw into exactly what you need. This is easier when your primary source of victory point coverage in the late game could come from victory tokens, and if you're relying less heavily on your provinces and colonies for whatever reason, then yeah, you could still prominently be able to get this. If provinces are your only card you have available to you and not colonies, it might actually work a lot better because you could use those as your target on Journeyman. You want to be careful, however, because as you continuously use Journeyman, you will basically put a large number of star cards into your discard pile. It could potentially affect reshuffling to a point where you may not have an option into this. In a game where you're going to have heavy trashing, this might not be one of your first targets, though it will help sift until you're ready to trash. If you're going to use this in thinning, you need trash for benefit that's going to give you the power you need that you're going to stick with one copy of. So for example, if you're using mine on your treasures, then you'll be able to effectively call out the card in particular. Now, funny enough, by that same extent, rebuild can also work that well too, if you can get the provinces out fast. I would not super heavily recommend this on the early game, only in the mid and the late game. Mid game more on the early side when you're still building the deck up and you still need to at least sift through some of the crappier cards you're dealing with. Late game, it's hard. It depends on what's available to you. You could call out random cards and sure, you're fine with that, but it's not going to have a super powerful effect. This is a more unique like draw card, but really can only be played in certain circumstances. It's very restrictive, but when it works, and it's not bad for its effect. Next up, we have a new treasure card that has an overpay effect, and that is Masterpiece. Costing at least 3 to purchase, generating 1 coin. When you overpay, gain a silver per 1 cost overpaid. Now, automatically, this is silver generation at its finest once again. On top of traders, trading posts, and this can help you get to a lot of silvers very quickly. Instead of having to purchase the silver directly for 3, you could say pay 4 or 5 on an opening and get 1 or 2 in addition to this card. Now, the major downside right off the bat, while it does cost 3, it generates 1. You're effectively gaining a copper to take those silver. So you need to make sure that if you're going to do this, you need its overpay effect. Otherwise, it is completely useless to you. This is good in a lot of big money strategies. Basically, silver flooding to raise your density overall. And if your price point is provinces, then this is going to work well for you. Though, be that as it may, your trash or benefit cards, including mine, will flood you with a lot of gold, and you can take advantage of a lot more potent power available to you. Surprisingly, this is where Feodim can gain a lot of power very quickly early on, if piling silvers is such a small risk that you can benefit from this. So that just works overall in big money strategies. Other than that, there's not much more to it. If you are effectively trying to build silvers without having to buy a single one, then yes, the cost of overpaying on Masterpiece is going to outweigh 10 times better than buying a silver outright. So you could at least gain a quicker attack on your opponent. And if trash for a benefit is already a factor in play anyway, trash Masterpiece. For its cost, it's definitely an early game card. I would not pick this up on the mid game or the late game unless you are looking at using those silvers very quickly for trash for benefit. If that is not a factor into that, don't. And limit yourself to maybe buying 1 or 2 Masterpieces overpaid. Do not buy this for its normal cost. You will lose out immensely. and it will hit you hard as a result of it. It's a unique treasure, but timed correctly and used in the right circumstances can start a very powerful engine and help you get to better price points in the game. So it's worth doing the overpay if you can afford it. Next up, we have a card that really drives home coffer generation in a huge way if played correctly, and that's Merchant Guild. Costing 5 to purchase, plus 1 coin, plus 1 buy. At the end of your buy phase this turn, plus 1 coffer per card you gain from it. Now, terminal payload, source of buy, nothing to scoff at. 5 costs, however, tough to chew on, but it can work. It can really work, especially in large mega turns, but I want to go into its weaknesses. Single copy by itself is not going to do much. You're going to need multiple copies of this card to really pour out coffer generation in a very, very huge way. And you need some deck control, which means you need some draw power and village support in order to really take advantage of this. And basically, the coffers you generate, well, since it's at your buy phase, you're waiting until the next turn to use them. So basically, playing multiple copies of this or King's Courting and Throne Rooming Merchant Guild is going to give you not only a ton of coffer generation, but also a ton of buys and some coin generation. Not a big issue there when you're tackling it up with that. Basically, being able to use coffer generation from Bridge, Highway, and Princess is going to help give you a lot of strength. When it comes time to start greening your deck heavily, having all those coffers saved up to buy in either as many provinces or colonies as possible is going to bolster being able to use this because you get some leftover change as a result of it. Consider it getting dividends off a big purchase on that. Couple other things to keep in mind, and it's just synergies. Now, surprisingly enough, Masterpiece works because even though you're buying the card and getting it on your buy phase, it's still when you gain any. So, purchasing Masterpiece and overpaying on it a few times means for every silver you get, you gain another coffer. That's going to be big in a lot of big money strategies, and it's going to help out a lot. Another thing to keep in mind, because of the way that works, basically the majority of first edition and second edition Hinterland cards are going to work wonders for you because you're basically going to be able to gain those cards and then get a secondary effect off of that. And so, for example, Nomads, in addition to gaining the coffer, you gain an extra plus 2. That works out great. Border Village, you gain a cheaper card. All of those are going to add up. Border Village is going to sync very well with this as a result of being able to just generate more coffers for every Border Village you get. And with cost for generation, you're gonna have a good streak. Merchant Guild rewards you for buying more and more cards. So the more coin you have, the more coffers you have, the more buys you have, and the cheaper the cards are, the more you are going to benefit from it. Another good idea, if you have Watchtower, especially in your hand, and you decide, well, maybe I should just buy junk generation this turn since I'm not going to get a lot of out of it, I can play Watchtower immediately after and basically trash all of that junk. It will basically give you a free turn of coffers. This is going to serve you 10 times better in the early game and in the mid game, but the late game is going to still help you generate coffers. This is what you need, though. You need a lot of draw power, you need multiple copies or a Throne Room in King's Court to help you out, and you basically need to be able to start building up on coin generation as much as humanly possible. Once you can do that, you are set, and you're going to get a lot of strength out of this. And even if you don't use the coffers for purchasing power, you could go ahead and just use Butcher's Effect over and over again, and that will just give you a lot of strength right then and there. So that's another way you can look around this. While on the surface it might not be a very powerful card, it can potentially gain power with the right set at the right time. And with that in mind, there is one card we have yet to talk about in this set that will basically synergize beautifully with this card. This is an excellent card, and I highly recommend it if you want coffer generation at its max. It is beautiful, and go for it. Next card up on the list is simply Plaza. Costing 4 to purchase, plus one card, plus two actions, you may discard a treasure for plus one coffer. Some new village support for the set, and some very interesting village support, I'll tell you that right now. At four, it's not bad. This is a decent discard for benefit way to generate coffers. And it has a couple of uses, depending on how you want to build your deck. But let's look at this, starting with the early game. You could discard a copper to gain a coffer. Yes, you break even one for one, technically. The coffer could be used on your next turn if your price point for that turn isn't going to be affected by a discarded copper, therefore making it a little bit easier to get to your future price points. Now, in Mega Turns, you could play multiple copies of Plaza to discard some treasures that you know is not going to benefit you. For example, if you overpaid on Masterpiece, but still have the Masterpiece in your hand, you can at least discard that for a coffer. Or even Ill-Gotten Gains to prevent you from putting out some more copper generation. Though, playing Ill-Gotten Gains could give you the copper generation needed for the discard, but I would be recommending Throne Room and King's Court at that point just to get them out of there. If your goal is to discard and rely heavily on the coffer generation, then surprisingly enough, Souk, as well as Poorhouse, might give you the maximum output of coin generation you need if you can get rid of the treasures in your hand, making those some very excellent synergy choices for this card. On the other side of that gain, if at that point you still want to draw into some more powerful effects and you have the village support, Watchtower, being able to draw up to six gives you an extra shot in being able to play some more cards and possibly more plazas. This is why Tactician is also good for either one of those two scenarios, giving you some adverse choice in this. So, early, mid, late game, this is good village support all around and can help you no matter what. And if you still have some coppers left by the end game, at the very least, if you're not going to be able to pull off a colony that turn, it can help you get to the colony next turn, possibly. So overall, it's not bad for village support. I like it. Coming up with three cards to go, we have a new action attack card, Soothsayer. Costing five to purchase, gain a gold. Each other player gains a curse, and if they did, draws a card. Now, in terms of gold generation, Soothsayer has the same price point as both Courtier and Bandit. While in this particular case, this is more of a curse generator than the two of them are. Now, simply put, gold generation, big money strategy, trash for benefit, nothing to sneeze at. It's that curse generation that is kind of okay-ish. It's not a super strong effect because of it. And hence why, if they gain the curse, they draw a card. Now, you could just lighthouse or moat the attack and you wouldn't get the curse. And if you did, you draw a card. However, the one upside for the player receiving the curse is Watchtower. Even if they gain the curse and use Watchtower's effect to trash it, they still technically gained it, so they still draw a card. So this is not super strong, so you're looking to use these in kingdoms that have very low amount of curse thinning or attack immunity. But at the same time, if there's not much in terms of curse thinning, you might overload yourself with too many golds. So you should be careful of how many times you play this, because golds are still stop cards. You could lose out on it. If you have trash for benefit, this is going to shine beautifully because you could basically just remodel into provinces, mine, and expand into platinums, and basically start working your way to some more expensive stuff. It doesn't need to be played too many times, and curse is unlimited anyway, but at the very least, there's some ways around the card. Now, because it is a curse, generator, on top of it being a gold generator, early game is where it's going to hit hardest the most, because then at the very least, they'll get the curses and get some junk. At the same time, you'll get the golds early on, so you'll be able to hit some price points very early. But by late mid into the late game and end game, don't pick it up, because at that point, you probably have enough golds as it is. The curses aren't going to do much except slow down your opponent. And if trash for benefit is a factor, then there's not going to be much power to it. Overall, it's okay. I mean, it's gold generation and curse generation. Not much more I can say. It's okay. Alright, so we have one last overpay card to take a look at in the form of Stone Mason. Costing two to purchase, trash a card from your hand, gain two cards each, costing less than it. If you overpay, gain two action cards each costing the amount overpay. Now, as a side rule for that overpay effect, if you overpay with a potion, then you can gain cards with potion at a cost. Just a little tidbit that's useful for you. But this is a powerful gainer. in the reverse way you would think of it compared to some other, like, workshop and remodel-like effects. And it does have a thinning ability, although, albeit, a little bit more unusual than some of the others. Let's look at the gainer part first. Now, you could make a purchase on a single buy for 6 or 7. Get the Stone Mason, you've overpaid either 4 or 5, you're going to get 2 cards costing 4 to 5 each. With that Stone Mason, that's going to give you a lot of versatility, as a lot of village support and draw power are usually within that range. Hell, Throne Room's in that range too, so that's useful. But the trashing is only useful in certain circumstances, especially not in the early game. So basically, that's going to give you a lot of problems. So this isn't used as a thinner. This is deck building at its finest. And that's why you also want to be careful with cost reduction. This is one of those few cards where cost reduction is more of a hindrance than it is anything else. However, in some unusual circumstances, this works out great. Gold generation, especially with Courtier, Bandit, and Soothsayer, you have something you can potentially use with golds, because you can trash the gold and gain something costing 5. You can get a lot of power out of that. Hell, you could turn platinums into provinces, you could turn provinces into king's courts, and king's courts into some very powerful 6-cost cards. You can turn them into golds, grand markets, and let's not forget one other particular card that works wonders with this, Merchant Guild. I said that there was a card that works wonders with Merchant Guild, and this is it. Because you overpay on Stone Mason to get 2 more action cards. In total, you get 3 for that turn for that one buy. That means you will get at least 3 coffers. That is an excellent synergy for that particular circumstance and gives you a lot of power. Because this is more useful on powerful cards rather than your cheap ones, this is going to be more valuable in the late game than it is going to be in the early game. When you're getting enough in coffers and platinums to just deck out colonies, you don't need that many platinums. You could probably thin it out and get some provinces along with it. You can increase your greening power, and that's going to be good. This is an acceleration of just not only deck building, but also pile up strategies, and that's going to be good. Because of that, you're looking at mid to late game for this card. If you got it early, then my suggestion is use it on something very expensive. If you have enough in coffers, if you can get a surprise gold, use it in conjunction with payment to pay for Stone Mason, get a couple of cards that are going to benefit for you, and then start building up the deck the way you want it to. And then once you have what you need, then get rid of the access with Stone Mason. While on the surface, this looks like a very weird card to be using, deep down, it has a lot of potential power and can basically help you win the game in one circumstance or another. Just be careful with how you play it. And the final card we're going to look at for guilds is Taxman. Costing 4 to purchase, new attack card. You may trash a treasure from your hand. Each other player with 5 or more cards in hand discards a copy of it or reveals they can. Then, gain a treasure onto your deck, costing up to 3 more than it. A little bit of a twist on mine. For the obvious reason where mine, you gain the treasure to your hand, Taxman, it goes to the top of your deck. Now, that attack, while it may be great, can be a little bit weak. Because first off, if coupled with any hand size attacks, Taxman will become completely useless to you if your opponent does not have at least 5 cards in hand. So that is going to be an issue right there. This isn't great for your starting coppers because of the fact that they're going to get top decked the moment you do them. You want to use these on probably a lot more powerful treasures. Now, fortunately, coupled with gold generation in a couple of ways, or even silver generation, then it can take off, especially when there's a variety of treasure cards that are available to you. What you're looking to do here is when you've cemented yourself enough treasure that you can force the sacrifice a lot better. But as the decks get bigger or thinner and there's less of the weaker treasure cards, it might not hit as much as you do. You'd be using Taxman for its trash effect anyway, more so than not. It can still be useful in the early part of the game. I mean, if they're hitting the silvers and the coppers, then you could hinder your opponent slightly. It is nice to do it this way, but Bandit kind of still tops Taxman in terms of destroying an opponent for treasures while still gaining a solid gold on top of it. I'm not saying it's bad, but if you're limited in treasures and your opponent might not even be using treasures to begin with, that attack's not going to go off for you. The other way to work Taxman beautifully is, since the card is going to get top deck, you might want to have some village support ready for actions, as well as some draw power to draw into those treasures. So if you can do that, you're basically going to be set up great. So being able to sift as well as top deck is going to help you immensely, and it's going to work well. I'd say mid game on the card, at least early mid, maybe even late early game. If you're going to start with your coppers first, then that's fine, because if there's a variety of treasures that will work wonders for you, then that will help you out immensely. Mid game, they're probably starting to get some golds, and if you have the gold generation, you can probably go right for the platinums too. So it at least prevents them from trying to go for the golds if they don't have any other options to them. Late game, probably a little too late to take advantage of it, but if there's no trash for benefit at all, at the very least you could use that for platinums to help you get to the colonies. It's an okay card, but in the right circumstances it can be potent, so just watch out for it. And with that, we've come to the end of Guilds. A fun little mini expansion. Nothing super crazy, but I like the mechanics that come with it. And seeing as though coffers will make a return in a future expansion, I look forward to checking out some of the cards there. We now are going to move on to Dominion's 9th expansion, which took almost 2 years to come out since Guilds, and that would be Adventurers. Now, Adventurers is going to introduce a lot of new mechanics and bring back some new duration cards. One of these mechanics will allow me to continue on my promo card quickie series, because I had been waiting to explain this mechanic before we got to that point. Going forward, we're gonna have a lot of big kingdom card piles, so get ready for it. Thank you so much for watching, guys. If you liked the video, be sure to give it a like and a comment. If you want to see more of my Dominion content, please hit that subscribe button. Every little bit helps out a lot. You can also check out my Twitter for updates, as well as my Twitch for streams. We're building up a good community there for Final Fantasy XIV and maybe a little bit of Mass Effect. I'd like to get some more people's intake. If this series turns out well, I'm willing to even take a look at some custom cards you guys are designing. So please send some stuff on me. Let's get some conversation going. Dominion needs a lot more love, especially with a new expansion on the horizon. I hope you enjoy the video again, guys, and thank you very much for watching. I hope you enjoy the rest of your week. Take care.